about what I'm about to talk to you guys about, and I got a little excited. So, you'll just have to excuse me. I'm gonna try to tone it down. That might be it. I'm gonna try to tone it down and keep within the 15-minute time period, so you're just gonna have to pray for me. So let's pray. Father God, I just thank you for another opportunity to come before your people. Father, I thank you more than anything else for your word. Father, because it is how we know you. It is how we understand you, and it's how we understand how to get closer to you. Father God, I just pray that you would speak tonight. Father, that I could step out of the way and just hide behind you, hide in your glory. Father, I pray that your word would go out and
Amen. It
would accomplish whatever you would have for it to do.
Thank you.
In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If I were to title my talk tonight, it would be, "It's Time to Change Your Perspective." You know, many of the times we get caught up in the things that are going on around us. We get caught up in the struggles that we have each and every day. We get caught up in the different disappointments that we've gone through. And we forget about who is in charge, who holds us up, even when we don't realize what's going on. You know, part of this story goes back about 11 months ago, 11 and a half, I lost my job. At the time I was praying, God helped me to find out how to simplify things so I can focus on you more, focus on what you'd have me to do. Next thing you know, I turn around and I get fired.
Wow.
I'm like, okay, Lord, that's not exactly what I was talking about, but okay. And so in the following 11 months, I went through some tough times. You know, I had to go to the county for assistance. There was plenty of times where it wasn't about whether or not I was going to bounce a check that month. It was about which checks were going to get bounced and how much I was going to have to pay. You know,
man.
At the same time, I started going back to school, figured, okay, I'll just do that. But, you know, this won't last more than, you know, a couple months, 6 months, and I'll be back to work. I'll get something. And then 6 months came and went, and I still didn't have a job. And then I was asked by my church to lead the local youth group, which I wasn't planning on doing. I had other things in the works, and it was not something I was prepared for, and so I had to depend on him. And then my housing became uncertain. I was sure I was going to be this close to being out on the street. And then, you know, over time, I started looking back, and I realized at the same time all this was going on, I was planning on building a house. Seriously, I was planning on building a house. I figured out what type of house I wanted to have, how I was going to do it, you know, what I wanted to do with that, how I was going to use it in ministry, and different things like that. And it wasn't, don't get me wrong, this is not a dream house. This is a house that should be good for my family. But I was thinking about it, and I'm like, you know, all of a sudden, I'm not worried about what's happening next. You know, this house thing is not going to happen right now. And it's going to need money. But I'm not worried about it. I'm trusting in God that it's going to happen. And so I was trying to think about why this had happened. And I started to look at the Psalms, and I came across the Psalm, the 23rd Psalm, one we know well. All of us know it. And God just started showing me some different things in it that I wanted to bring with you tonight. So, of course, the psalm starts off, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake." Now, David knew what a shepherd was. That was his first job. He knew what a shepherd was. And I would dare say he was pretty good at it. So he knew what a good shepherd was. And so he knew what came with that. And he also knew what being a sheep was. Sheep aren't the smartest of animals. Anybody who's worked with them will tell you that they're not the smartest. But a shepherd, because of the love he has for what he does, he brings them to the best pastures he can come across, the best watering that he can come across. You know, and what occurred to me, it says he leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Which, I don't know about you, but it kind of made me happy because I realized that it wasn't about me. I didn't have to do anything for him to lead me to these green pastures. It wasn't something that I had done that made him want to lead me to these still waters. The fact that he was giving me rest, that he was giving me peace, that he was giving me everything that I needed, did not have anything to do with myself. See, the fact is, God loves us in spite of ourselves. Amen. The Bible says before he knew us, before we knew him even, he loved us from the foundation of the world. Amen. So before your grandpappy was a gleam in your great-grandpappy's eye, he loved you. But not only that, he knew everything that you were going to do, and he still loved you.
Man.
For his name's sake. Because he is God, and he doesn't want to come down off the throne. See, that's the funny thing. Every time I messed up, and I messed up even in the last year, you know, I'd go and do my own thing and try to make things happen, and it would turn into a mess. And then God would make a way. Even when I was doing my own thing and really wasn't being as obedient as I should, he was still making a way because of his namesake.
Amen.
Not because of me. See,
Amen.
There were situations where I was in a mess. And I was rightly in a mess. And I just said, okay, I'm going to take my lumps. It's going to hurt. I don't know how I'm going to fix it, but I'm just going to take my lumps. And the next thing you know, God lets me stew in it. But I turn around and he's already fixed it. And I didn't even know. He's already fixed it and made me come out better than I went in.
Man.
Even though it was my fault. See, the fact Amen. Is sometimes as sheep we stray. And as a good shepherd, he goes and gets us. And sometimes he breaks our legs so that we come back and have to stay close to him. But he's still going to bring us back to those green pastures. He's still going to lead us beside those still waters. And that's, if you haven't figured out, where we find rest, where our soul gets restored. And then the next part, you know, it says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they cover me. And I was reading a commentary, and the first thing that stood out to me was the fact that it said, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. See, the first thing you have to understand is, the valley is not your destination.
Amen.
You're going through some trouble. You're going through some heartache. You're going through some disappointment. But the valley is not your destination. You will come out on the other side eventually. You will come out into another mountain pass. You will come out into another lighted area. The other thing you have to understand is it said the shadow of death. The commentator said, you know, understand that the shadow of the sword is not the dangerous part. It's not the sword, it's the shadow of the sword. So you don't have to worry about it. But then I started thinking about it. And I started remembering that in Revelations, the first chapter, Christ says, I am the one who was dead and was raised. And behold, I'm alive forevermore. And I have the keys of death. And hands. Understand that at the end of the day, as much as death is a thing that we all have to face, and as much as death can be final and tragic for those who are here, death is still not a destination. See, the fact is, he took the teeth out of death. Amen. See, why did he say, death, where is your sting? Grave, where is your victory? He took all of that stuff away. For those of us who are in Christ, we need to know that even if it comes down to death, the valley is not the destination. If it comes down to death, we know there's something even greater on the other side.
That's right.
Even in death, we know that when we close our eyes here, we're going to see him next thing we know.
Yeah.
So it's an end of suffering. It's an end of toil. So again, it's not the destination. So we need to understand that we just got to keep going. We got to press on through. We got to do what we need to do to follow him, because it talks about his rod and his staff. Understand, the rod, he used to lead the sheep. The staff is used to protect them from predators. So he's leading you and he's protecting you. He's got you covered. The next thing it goes on to say is, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. My cup runneth over. The thing that stood out to me there was, even then, he does not leave us. We don't do the work. He sits and prepares the table. We're still resting in his green pastures. We're still walking by his still waters, and he's preparing the table. So we're not there yet. So he's going before us, and those people who are talking about us, he's preparing a table in front of them. Those people who are lying on us, he's preparing a table in front of them. Those people who are backbiting, he's preparing the table already. And you don't have to do nothing. All you have to do is follow the shepherd. The table's already prepared. And understand that when you sit at the table, he's not leaving you there. They're not eating. You're sitting there eating in front of them. But understand why that's happening. Because he's with you. He still hasn't left you. He still hasn't forsaken you. I think back to the idea of on the playground. You know, if you have a big brother, 6, 7, 8 years older than you, you might be pushed around when he's not there. There might be people who will pick on you or leave you out or whatever when he's not there. But if he comes on the playground, they're going to start treating you different. Especially if he has a reputation. Now understand that our God is the baddest thing on the block. Amen. And he's saying, I got you. So why are you worried?
Amen.
You know, he's saying, I got you. So who's going to touch you when he gets on the playground?
Amen.
So he's preparing the table before you. You know, I was also going through Psalms 121, where it says, I look up to the hills from which cometh my help, because my help comes from the Lord. Understand that when you're in the valley, there's only one place to look if you're going to get out. You got to look up.
Amen.
You know, when you're in trouble, there's only one place you can look that you're going to find help. You got to look up. This is about changing your perspective. The next thing I was thinking of, the best analogy I could come up with for understanding what I'm talking about is riding on a plane. If you ride on a plane, when it takes off, you're on the ground. You leave. Now, on the ground, there could be a snowstorm. It could be raining, thundering, lightning, whatever. And as you climb, you're going to go through some rough patches. Might be some turbulence. But once you get above the clouds, your view changes. Once you get above the clouds, you see a nice, cushy surface. Calm. You can see the sun. It's bright. You don't have so much wind or turbulence. The fact is, when you get above the clouds, your perspective changes, and you can see a little bit farther. When we're in the valley, we can't see what's on the other hill. But once we look to Jesus, he can change our perspective. He can lift us up out of the mess that we're in and allow us to see what was coming next. What I was figuring out after this had all happened, and I'm coming up onto a year of being unemployed, was that despite being in the middle of my mess, he had changed my perspective. In the middle of my mess, he allowed me to see something that was coming on next. I didn't know how I was going to get there, just like we don't know how the plan lands. We know that it's going to go up, but we're trusting the pilot to get us back down on the ground safely. Just like we have to trust the good shepherd to get us back to the corral safely. Just like we know that the good shepherd is going to take us through that valley safely. His rod and his staff is going to get us there. His angels are going to encamp around about us. We don't got to worry about it. The question is, where's your perspective? Are you his? Understand, as much as he loves you and as much as he wants to do all these good things for you, you've got to be his first. It's not hard. All you have to do is bow your knee and say, what I'm doing ain't right. I recognize that. I want to go your way. Father, I recognize that you're who Christ, that you died on the cross for me. And I accept that. And that's where you start. If you are, what are you looking at? What are you seeing in your view? See, the other thing about the valley of the shadow of death is that it says, I won't fear. What is fear? False evidence appearing real. That means that the devil is trying to make you see something that's not there.
Come on.
Yeah. Amen.
Nobody said you couldn't make it through the valley. It said you will, actually. But when we get in the valley, we feel like we can't make it. We don't know how to get out. Because there's false evidence appearing real. He's trying to show us that this mess is too big for us. That this problem we can't overcome. That this thing that's in our way is too big for us to get over. Fact is, sometimes he's right. But we got a trump card. And that card is Jesus Christ. That card says, I don't care what the problem is. I don't care what the situation is. I got you. That card says, you lay it down, and I don't care what they got. You win.
Amen.
But the question I have for you is, if you know him, what's in your way? Sometimes we let trees block our view. Sometimes we let issues get in the way of us having our minds and our hearts and our eyes fixed on Jesus. Sometimes we let sin, failures, insecurities, disappointments get in the way. Are you going to do that, or are you going to go to him and say, Lord, I want to be your sheep? It doesn't mean you have to be smart. It doesn't mean you have to have it all together. What it means is you have to be ready to follow. That's all the shepherd asks of the sheep. Where's your perspective? God bless you.